meeting the other artists. It was super cool. Just wanted to thank Stony for putting it all together. I wanted to thank the Natural History Center as well. Everybody's been really helpful for me in finding things I needed. When I was putting this talk together, I was kind of coming across the difficulty of a lot of the work that I make kind of is to fill spaces that I don't know how to talk about. So then trying to express the inexpressible becomes difficult. I'll kind of go through some of my work and some influences, and then I'll end with some stuff I've been working on at the residency. So I wanted to talk about kind of comic and zine making first, since that's kind of the fun play aspect of my practice that I always seem to come back to. I got really into zine making the freshman year of high school, and I think that was kind of important for me just to be exposed to more like experimental, radical thinking, absurdist kind of artwork and ideas, and seeing that those were options that I could follow. Also realizing that I really liked bookmaking and making zines. You can just control a lot of little aspects of the process and the layout of it. I really like playing with kind of the organization of layouts, like for this one, Purple Rain. It has a lot of collage elements from different like vintage science illustrations and comic books and things. It's about a disembodied alien head that loves Prince's album Purple Rain. And I was looking through this theme and it said there's like a part where the alien is like experiencing this wordless connection or joy with the music and feeling alienated and then having that connection. And I think that does tend to be a through line in a lot of my work, that kind of nonverbal connection through music and art that can be really helpful. So here's another comic that I did. It was for a group zine called Brine, but I cut it out and it folds into a little accordion book. I was having a lot of fun with like, the structure there. The kind of graphic influences that I have, the left hand one is Charles Burns. He made a comic called Black Hole that I was really inspired by. He uses a lot of kind of intricate natural textures, science dissections, and I really loved like, the mark making and line work as well. The story features these teenagers kind of going through grotesque mutations, and it's really a metaphor for their coming of age and adolescence. And I think often in my work, I'll explore the grotesque as part of these ways to deal with personal things on this imagined plane. The one on the right hand is Mobius. I would say like he was a comic influence and also just an influence for my work in general. I love the way that he makes like kind of proliferating myriad forms in his little micro world. He referred to himself as taking excess in a refuge of detail, which is something I definitely relate to. He also said that he was like an alcoholic commuting his alcohol, like he needed to go back to comics, even when he was working on other projects. And I always do find myself doing that, just to kind of bring back like a playful spirit to my work. Some of my work can be kind of dark, so it's good to have those kind of few elements to go between. Here's a few music festival posters that I made for a couple of years for a festival in town. I'm definitely inspired by kind of that playing with the layout. And a poetry scene I made for an art show a couple of years back. This piece was kind of the first larger scale drawing I was doing and that kind of went into that show I was putting together. It took me like a year to complete because I took a long break in the middle. It was like during elections, like stressed. But it was really rewarding for me just trying to work larger and really get immersed in the piece. I had a few influences kind of for the texture around this. Let's see. Oh. this one, Ernst Haeckel, he was a German science illustrator in like the 1800s. I found this sometime in high school, and I was really entranced by the different intricate forms, especially like the marine life forms. It started getting me more into just falling in love with science illustration as a reference. Just the level of detail of that, like I feel when I'm drawing these forms, that I can get into like a meditative state of feeling closer to the intricacy of natural forms, I think. I was also using kind of cyanotype printmaking as a reference for a couple of these pieces. Cyanotypes are a photo printing method that was used a lot until like the late 20th century. It was like a low-cost form of printmaking. That's where the term blueprints comes from. But yeah, again, I was just really into the intricate level of detail of these and also the reversal of light and shadow. Like some of these pieces from this time kind of deal with difficult emotional states, and I found that it was a different experience kind of drawing the light places onto dark paper. This piece definitely inspired by kind of surrealist artwork. There's a few things that really attracted me to working in a surrealist style. It kind of has the themes of automatic drawing or like drawing from the well of the unconscious to kind of deal with parts of yourself that might not make rational sense. And we have a few more from that series that kind of explore that, kind of have the surrealist style going as well. I was really experimenting with embroidery on the paper around this time, which is not something I've really tried before. I think part of me liking putting sewing into my work has to do with my grandmother, who made quilts for a long span of her life, and those were mostly for the church. She would give them away, and it was really like an art practice that was more about the act of doing, I think. And she was one of the first people that I knew that was really like a maker and an artist, and also fostered kind of like the way that I wanted to relate to nature, I think. But it's interesting to me to be using this like sewing, or like it felt like making the pieces into a quilt, but then obviously the subject matter is upsetting. So it's interesting to combine those two things. Like, it definitely made me feel that the work was more concrete and a record at that time, I think. All right. This one was based off of this book called The Atlas of Animal Anatomy that I was drawing a lot from. The resolution is not as good as I thought. But it kind of, like, a lot of my work will combine these different organic forms and kind of imagine them all sort of amalgamated together. And I think it kind of celebrates, like, proliferation of life, but also, like, the level of fear and uncertainty with, like, what's going on inside of your body, just sometimes reflecting on that and dealing with it. This one, I was kind of dealing with death and decay in some of these pieces. I was hiking a lot around that time, and I found like a deer carcass that was slowly decaying, and just kind of like watching the stages of decay, and that kind of features in this piece. I think a lot of the stuff around this time has disconnected hands, and I think part of that has to do with like when I'm making my work, then I feel like less of my body and more just of this creating space, and that can be a space to connect with nature and with these life and death processes, and in a way that making it beautiful in some way can add sort of an acceptance of that. This one is based off of the mythology of Baba Yaga. I was attracted to that because I think I often think about like how to age with grace or outside of what society wants you to do. And to me, Baba Yaga is an example of that. She's got that figure from Russian mythology and kind of in some ways maligned as evil, but then ultimately having a great deal of wisdom and traveling around in her house with the bird legs of her mortar and pestle. This is called Save the Grace Being Torn. It was about the phenomena of when like two bucks would fight, or I think it's like when a buck will fight another buck, but the other one is dead, so the head like comes off. But anyway, it was like kind of dealing with that unnerving decay process and thinking about that. Like when I looked at pictures of this, it looked almost like the two were embracing. And that was that strange like contradiction of the embrace and that it was not benevolent. And just think about that in terms of the complexity in human relationships at times. All right, so I started getting into working with cloth a little bit more. I would say that was like during the start of the pandemic. I was partly inspired by some of Louise Bourgeois' work. She was a French-American artist that was mostly known for like large-scale sculpture and installations. She also worked with a lot of printmaking and cloth web making from the kind of fabric scraps she had around. And a lot of her work kind of dealt with these recurring themes in her life of kind of dealing with relationship with her body, with death and decay, with childhood traumas and things. And I think one thing that really stuck out to me about her was that she carried her work through her life as a life process to process things as a way of purging feelings, and also just really having an extremely expansive practice for like the different types of medium she was willing to explore and the bravery of that work. So I made a couple of cloth books during the start of the pandemic. I saw them as kind of visual journals at that time. I have a few little found items I had collected, like the metal piece on that one. Some kind of collected items. So this one as well. As a job when I found it, it was stained with some beet juice and wine. Alright, then there's this coat that I made as well. It's made out of a vintage wedding dress that I kind of repurposed it for my own thing. I just wanted it to kind of feel like an artist coat, like wearing that coat of like the choices that I made. That's different from being married, obviously, like just going into my own personal space. The text under the pockets of that reads, "Our bodies beg to be noticed." All right, so now I'm coming to kind of some of the stuff I've been working on at the residency. I didn't have a specific plan going in, but when I was looking through the collection here, I got really into the nests. They have all the nests that are on that wall, but also like a whole collection of nests in the little shelves in the back, like birds and wasps' nests. And I just started getting interested, I think, in different structures built by animals, like nests and like termite mounds and cocoons and things I just think are really interesting to study how animals make. And I'm not sure how I want to incorporate that into my work yet, but it's something I'm exploring. I've been working on this thing like three-dimensionally, which is new for me. So thinking like how can I work three-dimensionally inspired by animal structure? That's a question that I'm still figuring out. But I found out a few interesting nest facts. This is the great bower nest. It's a bird from Australia. And it just has like an interesting ritual around it. Like the male bird will make this nest and then litter the ground with everything he can find. And it is supposed to all be like one color, or if there's more than one color, then they have to be separated by a little space, and it's all like to attract the female. It's not even like a nest for the offspring, like she has her own separate nest. This is just for show. Couple wasps' nests. I kind of found a few that were around here and amalgamated that into this drawing. I was learning a little bit about wasp stuff. I was reading the Natural History Center magazine, which is really good, but they had an article on parasitoid wasps, and they were talking about how like Charles Darwin used wasps as a reason that creationism couldn't exist, because like God had never created wasps. But I think they're pretty cool. I was looking up as well that like it's a legend that 2,000 years ago, this Chinese paper inventor was watching how wasps work to learn how to make paper. I think it's pretty cool since I work so much with paper. But yeah, that first paper was made from like tree bark, hemp waste, old rags, and fish nets, the original one. I drew this kind of nest building chimera as well. I think that one of my kind of returning to, I think, like the comic drawing style. And then there's this that turned into the chair thing. It definitely reminded me of how non-linear my process is. Like I was trying to make it a tapestry at first, and then I think it was like too two-dimensional for me, and I almost didn't feel like it was like doing the animals justice. Like one thing that I really like with coming in here is like how the wall feels like it's jumping out at you. Like all the creatures, like I definitely watch kids getting really excited about that. And I think that is a cool thing about this place, that it gets you excited to learn a bit more about the animals. And I wanted to reflect kind of that animacy in this piece. I'm adding a few kind of structures on the outside of it that I have over here, but I'm still building. It definitely reminds me a little bit of making comics and just trying to explore and experiment and add pieces on it. I'm really grateful to have the space to be able to do that. I think this one is also kind of inspired by like some of my grandmother's quilting and her cabin that I had visited this summer for the first time since I was a kid, and just kind of like how do I want to be in relation to nature, and then there's kind of this just sitting in reverence or meditation. So I think maybe that's partly why it's like this chair shrine. But I'm interested to see where that goes. All right. So that is the end of my talk, but I'd just like to open it up for any questions you guys have.
Hi, Val. Can you talk a little bit about your process leading up to creating the finished pieces? Do you do a lot of sketchwork, or are you working in pencil and then overlaying with ink, or like just more context into the physical sort of process of getting to these? Because they're so intricate.
It really depends on the work. Like, I would say with some of the earlier ones that are like large scale pieces, I would spend a lot of time just like sketching them in. And like I never seem to know where it's gonna go at the beginning. Like it's like, I think with that first one that like has the Earth's Temple and cyanotype inspiration, I just was kind of drawing different textures and then like building something out of them and then moving towards something and layering a bunch of stuff until like the figure. So, but some of them I just like end up drafting a lot. lot too. So I would say this has definitely been something where I'm just kind of going for it and seeing what it has to tell me.
Tracy, can you speak to, I don't know, something about transmutation and like your process of discovery? I mean, it's interesting. When I came in here last week, this was maybe a shrine.
Yeah.
And also I was really interested in your comment about it referencing your, I mean, at least having some relationship with your interest in comics. Have you built a comic before in the round? Can you speak to any of that?
Like three-dimensionally?
No,
I think that would be really fun to do.
Did you reference that though? Like that this kind of almost became or becomes like a comic in,
yeah,
like standing comic?
I think I'm definitely like, when I'm putting a book together, I keep thinking about the way like all the little structures and sequences will fit together. And I've been trying to do that with like working three-dimensionally, but I'm not sure yet how that fits together. It's just, it kind of feels similar, I think, partly in just trying a new media. But like, I mean, when I'm drawing comics, I like to build different like structures in them that intersect and entangle. So maybe that's kind of where I was coming from with the comparison.
So to piggyback on that, is it a process of discovery for you? Do you kind of like have one thread that you follow and that opens up the next paths? Or how are you picking your path during your process of making?
That's a really good question. I feel like I just find my way as I'm going, which is the hard part to explain. Like, I definitely notice that with this. And like, I kept saying it's like a kite or like a shrine or a curiosity cabinet. But, then it just kind of takes form that I can figure out where it's going.
I have a question.
Go ahead, quick.
Oh.
Please.
So I'm really interested in this this part of your work where you're kind of discovering what it's about as you go.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of like your art being into your future or your the path that you're kind of walking or talking about as a new you. So let's see. I guess I want to ask a couple things. One is Do you have a process for having dialogue with your work in terms of inquiring what it's about, or is it happening randomly, or are there certain time frames that it happens in?
Is there like a dialogue with my work?
Yeah, like
yeah.
Do you consciously sit down and say, okay, now we'll do a dialogue? I'm just curious what that is like.
Yeah, I've definitely just sat there and like, what are you about? You know, and like putting different things, trying different things, and just seeing what feels right. One part, and then that opens up like then to the next thing. But I never do think of it as like a fully executed thing, like at the beginning. Like, I love studying like science illustrations of things because it just like makes me feel like thinking in a different way about it, like all these possible like rich and complexities that you could follow. If that makes sense.
I have one more question that kind of made me think. Do you like to have a structure with your time? Do you come in at a certain time, or do you like to just come in when you feel like coming in? Or how do you do that? Or are you? It looks like you spend quite a bit of time on your art.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends on the thing. Like for this, I've been kind of coming by like as many days of the week as I can, and just hanging out here to kind of be at the natural history desk for a little span of time. But yeah, for the different ones, it really depends. Like, a lot of the time I will just work on them, like, when the spirit moves me, I guess. But sometimes it's been really helpful for me to just have, like, a month block of time, and that's the thing I work on, and I try to just touch it every day in some way. And I like how it feels to like add something every day for a month or something, and you'll see like that it's like a record of that time as well.
You might have already touched on this, but especially in your earlier work, did you ever get to the point where you had the dialogue, moving along, you're really happy, and then you just had to abandon it? And if you did abandon it, did you blame the piece? Or did you blame the election?
Definitely blame the election. But I would say I would have put so much time into it at that point that I'd be like, well, I have to keep going, but I'm not happy about it. And some there have been a few of them that I like, didn't put in this because I have more ambiguous feelings on them. But I don't know. Like, it's almost like by sewing on them much and putting a bunch of detail, I'd be like, well, I have to care about this because it like reminds me of all the like days that I was working on it and like that I was trying to make this like sacred object. So it kind of, I don't know, like I feel frustrated by them sometimes.
Do you feel any tension between your work as a, you know, on one hand you're following through your subconscious and then that will lead you. On another hand, you know, the commissions to people, and there's no need to say those two things.
I mean, I haven't been doing as many commission stuff things this year. I kind of decided to take a bit of a break from that. I don't love it as much, but like with commission stuff, a lot of it is like portrait drawing and stuff, and that kind of helps me to just practice skills, so I try to see it as doing that. And also it's fun to draw portraits and things, because then you can try to capture the essence of the person, and that's a challenge. Like to make it really look like them to people that would know them. But that's mostly my commission work, and then like for comics and things, that's kind of stuff I do just to stay loose as to one of the other resident artists likes to say.
Yeah, just out of curiosity, is any other media kind of
Yeah, I mean, I'm really, as you know, Gus, I'm a very big music nerd. I was a DJ at KBGA, the college radio station here, for like 6 years, and I really like kind of experimental, just interesting, like indie music and different types of spoken word, and I find that like really helps me in like the creative process to listen to a bunch of new music and be finding stuff all the time.
For this?
Yeah. I listened to a lot of Joanna Newsom while I was here. She's like a harp player. It's a good soundtrack for like sewing and doing crafts. It makes me feel like a folk artist.
Tracy, what about your education background? You studied creative writing and English, right? Where did this emerge, or what's the relationship between those parts?
I mean, I've always really liked drawing since I was younger. Like when I was doing like whatever, taking notes in school, it was just mostly drawings, and like that's just a way that I really relax and meditate. And I think when I was in school for English, I like to write, but I found it more difficult to write, thinking about all the things I was supposed to be doing and kind of the anxiety of trying to express myself and not finding the words. And I think I kind of went more towards visual art in some ways to try to deal with that kind of uncommunicable space. But I'm still really in love with like building stories and kind of personal mythologies and things, and so that appears in my work. And sometimes trying to figure out ways into that, I think.
Thanks. Awesome. Thanks, Tracy.